This conference has got a theme, which is sustainability. We've all been talking about sustainability with a lot of different viewpoints, with a lot of different appreciations and understandings. And I wonder if sometimes we don't get just a little bit too sophisticated for our own good. Sustainability, in our terms, is largely focused upon one fundamental, and that's the profitability of our operation, the ability of us to remain in business. And right now, that's a tough call. The economy is really, really bad around the world. For all of the incredible designs and ideas that we might have, we have to face reality. Asia, for all of us, is a very important area of growth. A number of people around the world that think Asia is paved with gold and that you can do no wrong here. Well, it's very, very far from the truth. We're actually faced with some enormous challenges in Asia. People in Asia are very demanding. Business people in Asia are extremely shrewd, and they understand the challenges which they face, just like any other business, and we must not take for granted the need to be profitable, because that is sustainability. So, what I want to look at is the development of golf in terms of the challenge which they face and the need to produce better turf. Yesterday I talked about better turf, better grass for less money. In order for us to stay in business, we have got to produce a standard of golf to the average player that is appealing. And this is simply not acceptable. And you've all seen this sort of presentation around the country. It doesn't do your reputation any good at all. Mediocrity is, in fact, the source of our dilemma. Mediocrity is very often something which we just take for granted, and we don't look carefully at what we've been building and question whether or not we need to continue accepting this sort of appearance. We can produce golf conditions like this. All around the world, there are spectacular and beautiful golf environments. This is what the player sees as he walks onto the golf course. It's all very well raising people's expectations, but we have to then deliver on the expectation. And it doesn't matter whether you're in hospitality, if you're in a restaurant, in a hotel, you've got to deliver to the customer's expectation. And this is the sort of quality that we're looking for. So we have to start asking ourselves, what makes a successful golf course? What are people after? One of the issues that we seem to have forgotten, and I think it's one of the sources of our problems around the world, is that golf needs to be a fun experience. And what's a fun experience? What is it? What do we expect from a golf course? It's about playability. And playability is talked about in so many different ways. And I wonder if people really think about the reality of playability. It's about speed, trueness, and bounce. After the construction has taken place, after all that wonderful work has been done and the huge investment has been made, how do we maintain, that is to keep at a standard, speed, trueness, bounce? It's measurable. It's something which in golf course maintenance we can really impact. And most of that comes from the machinery that we use. This is what we're looking for. We talked about Mission Hills. Here it is. This is the original Mission Hills development. And this is where the Amiga Open was played, the World Cup. It took us 3 years of intensive work with the Mission Hills team to produce from what had been extremely mediocre, unattractive, non-performing golf courses. It took 3 years of extraordinary work as a team developing and redeveloping what the designers had originally intended and what had been allowed to fall into disrepair. This is all about profit, and that is all about sustainability. This is the key to the whole thing. So, how are we going to focus our attention upon profit and sustainability? In today's world, like any other business, we're all in business, we have got to reduce our input costs. How are we going to do that? Reducing costs is not easy. So what are we going to do? Well, first of all, and this is something I raised yesterday, how many people really understand that as turf maintenance specialists, we are effectively doctors of the turf? The superintendent and his team in golf course maintenance are turf doctors. And yet, astonishingly, in asking the question yesterday in front of the maintenance group, how many of you have got what effectively is a stethoscope for the doctor? Now, the stethoscope is effectively this device here, a portable microscope. Yesterday, not one single person in the room who was practicing golf course maintenance, apart from a consultant, has one of these. If you go to a hospital with a bad cough, and the doctor that examines you doesn't have a stethoscope, doesn't listen to your chest, you'd be pretty fed up. And yet, the majority of the people we pay quite large salaries to, who are charged with the task of taking care of the patient, the zillions of grass plants, they don't have a stethoscope. And in terms of communication, many of them don't understand the need to stick their bottom in the air and demonstrate to the customers who are paying for them how they are looking at the patient and at the playing surface on which the playability, the fun aspect of golf, is going to be performed. If they did, this is what they might see. It's not a pretty sight. Very often, owners and developers, general managers, haven't got a clue about the war zone that the superintendent is dealing with. This is the source of a massive part of the expenditure that goes on in running the golf course on a day-to-day basis. And what you're looking at here is damaged turf that's been caused by the cut. This is what it could look like, and it's not very difficult to get there. This is going to produce, this type of turf is going to produce a smooth surface. It's going to support the ball. It is going to create trueness. It's going to create speed. It's going to create happy golfers at every single level, from the simplest amateur golfer, somebody who really can't play like me, and somebody who is playing in tournaments. And because of our ability to produce and to move from that to that, we're charged with taking care of the preparation of most of the famous tournaments around the world, including the one that's going on here at Empire. So how are we going to avoid this sort of war zone, this damage which can cost us such a lot? This damage which can effectively turn into the use of excessive water, excessive amounts of fertilizer, excessive amounts of fungicide, and excessive amounts of fuel to run the mowing equipment. You want to talk about sustainability? Lower those input costs. We have a responsibility not only to the environment, but also to our own commercial enterprises to lower those input costs. And how? It's simple. This is not a massive and complicated science. Can we get the sound on this one? What we're talking about here is the simple process of sharpening. It's not difficult. There are plenty of different types of machine out there which will sharpen very, very adequately. What we focus on is doing the job very fast, very simply, and inexpensively. And by sharpening on a regular basis, by producing an extremely good cut, we can do a number of things. What you're seeing here is a cutting unit that has been sharpened, reel and bed knife, in under 9 minutes. You'll notice that this reel is not touching the bed knife. In other words, the brakes have been taken off. Now, many of you probably won't even notice what's going on the golf course, but would you drive your car home with the handbrake half on? Hands up, how many of you would drive your car home with the handbrake half on? Stupid idea. And yet, we as an industry invest huge amounts of money in mowing equipment, which is very sophisticated, very expensive, beautifully designed, and then when we watch it being destroyed systematically by being driven round with the handbrake on. In other words, we have an expensive horse with five cutting units like this attached to it, and the reels are so tight that you're totally destroying the engine, costs a fortune, the hydraulic systems leaking everywhere. The cost of the fuel is massive, and it gives rise to horrendous costs in terms of the agronomy, the quality of the turf, and the playability. And yet we just don't focus on something as basic and fundamental as sharpening the mowers, which are going to be used to cut this beautiful turf in which you've invested a fortune every single day. Something as obvious as that. If you think about it, the best performance you get on a green is after you've actually sharpened, and I do not mean lapped, I mean sharpened a mower. So at the beginning of a season, when the mowers have been properly sharpened, that is the best possible playing condition you get. And yet what do we tend to do? Destroy our machines very quickly thereafter by doing all sorts of necessary groundworks, aeration, top dressing, coring, and so on. And then we don't sharpen. We just go into a regular routine maintenance. Now here, you're looking at two areas of turf. The top one has been double cut using a lapped mower. And this is very good turf, extremely good quality. The lower part of the picture shows the same turf having been cut once only by the same mower that has been properly sharpened in just a few minutes. Already we're getting half the amount of fuel that's being used. We're seeing a mower being used half as much, half as frequently, and we're seeing half as much labor. You want to save some money? There's a good start. And this goes on and on and on. Why the difference? Well, from an agronomic point of view, if you look at turf that's been mown by a sharp mower, it looks like this. This is grass that's been taken off a green. It's been put on a slide. It's had a special chemical injected into it so that any broken cells can be identified as being a yellowish color under a special light. What we're looking for is to see how many cells on a blade tip are actually damaged. And the area that we're looking there, if that's the tip of a blade of grass that we're looking under a microscope, that's the bit we're looking at, the top end of my little finger. So in other words, you get a picture of how close we're looking at the turf. And what you can see here is lignin. That's the stuff that makes the grass blade stand up. And we're seeing here a much smaller surface area and the area of damage. And this damage down here is actually the damage that's caused as the mower moves across the turf and the bed knife is causing that sort of damage from the grass. This is a well-prepared lapped mower and the way that the grass appears after being mown by that mower. And just look at the difference in the amount of yellow tissue. You're looking at spores, disease, waiting for somewhere to happen. A group of spores here, spore there, spore there. You learn to identify spores. This is the disease that's going to cost us a lot in terms of the repairing process. The yellow is all the damage which needs to be repaired as the plant tries to recover from being murdered every single day. So, why would we want to allow our grass, first of all, to be a much greater receptor of spores? We're providing here significantly more surface area. We're providing a mashed up blade of grass which is going to bleed for longer. It's going to lose its nutrient. It's going to lose water, transpiration. And it's going to cost a fortune to fix it up. And the plant is going to have to repair itself using valuable reserves of nutrient, and therefore it's going to cry its eyes out and tell you, give me more food, give me more food. So we have to protect it. We've got to put antiseptic on it. We're going to have to give it water because it's losing it all to the atmosphere, and we're going to have to give it more food in order to repair the damage that's been done. How sensible is all of that? So what? Well, think about the research that's been done. Every time we mow, we damage the plant. We have to mow. Dull blades create more damage. You've just seen it. And fungal spores thrive on that damaged area of turf. Now think about the money. This is all about money. And we've got to get back to basics. If we are going to throw money at repairing grass that's been damaged, repairing grass that's become sick, we're going to not only spend money on identifying, not only spend money on the chemicals which we use, but very often in Asia, people who are extremely clever at running their businesses on a day-to-day basis get to the golf course and make stupid decisions to buy cheap stuff, cheap chemicals. If there's something wrong, chuck water on it. Just keep chucking on the water. The water costs a fortune. The cost of chemicals is not just buying chemical, which very often you'll find people are spending far, far more than they need to. It's also about the mixing, the calibration. The best and most trained staff that you're likely to employ are the ones who will have the licenses to spray chemical. These people could be doing other valuable jobs on the golf course in terms of turf maintenance. Water, which, whether you agree or not, one day it is going to become the most precious resource which we do not have. The idea that there's plenty of water around this globe may in one sense be true, but how much of that water is going to be accessible to us, and how long is it going to be before it is no longer socially acceptable for us to waste water as we do at the moment? The water not only costs a lot from the point of view of the resource, but frequently the next step is that we get into handling recycled water. We're forced to use recycled water, which has the effect of accumulating salts, which then need to be flushed. And there's a whole complex area associated with water management. But how many people, particularly superintendents, know what the cost of moving the water around the golf course really is? It's massive. The cost of electricity is far, far greater than the actual cost of the water in many cases. This lot, not only as equipment, costs a lot of money, but the running of it. And you know, most people don't have a clue. And you've got all the equipment there to tell you how much this is costing, and they don't check. Fertilizer, again, it's not just about buying the fertilizer, which very often is not the best fertilizer. It's simply fertilizer which they can get at cheaply because I know a friend, I have a friend who supplies it, this sort of thing. It's not sensible. Fertilizer, again, costs labor, handling, calibration, the deterioration of the equipment. And the nitrogen that goes into the ground, coupled with the water, produces thatch. Thatch has become, without doubt, one of the most significant challenges on Asian golf courses. Thatch is something that we create. We encourage the natural development of the grass to form thatch. And we do it by chucking on too much water, too much fertilizer, and by damaging the blades of grass in the first place. So a lot of the cost of handling thatch, a lot of the cost associated with aeration and dethatching, which upsets play, upsets the management, can be avoided by good practices. And then, of course, we come to top dressing, our favorite challenge, which used to be about maintaining the right level of organic content in the upper layer of where the feeding roots are. Now, top dressing is used as a means of producing a uniform speed and performance of the ball. So in other words, we're trying to lay down a bit of a carpet for the ball to roll on. If we mow with very sharp reels, we don't need to do that. In many places in Asia, it's very difficult to find and to acquire uniform quality sand. The Japanese spend a fortune on having carefully prepared and selected sand at great expense. This is the sort of area which we've got to start focusing upon and finding ways of cutting costs. Workshop management. How many places have you seen that look like this? How many golf courses work in the most appalling conditions? How many courses have got staff working in conditions that you wouldn't have your own gardener working in? A lack of air conditioning, a lack of cleanliness, a lack of decent conditions in which they can operate. It is not only unfair, dare I say, and with respect, it's stupid. These are the people that are supposedly maintaining the golf course, producing that quality on which your reputations depend, whether you're the architect, whether you're a developer, whether you're a general manager, or a private owner. Your reputation depends upon the output from that workshop. This sort of waste, I think, is folly. This, on one of the golf courses in South China, after processing, reprocessing all of this stuff that had just been stuck on the shelves, saved them $35,000. $35,000. What a total and utter waste of their resource. We have to stop it. We've got to start thinking about the reality. We've got to take a magnifying glass and look at our golf operations with some common sense. And the more gifted individuals who have recognized this will take something which is a fairly crummy building and renovate it and turn it into this. And this doesn't cost much money. Bit of paint, some decent lighting, putting some paint on the floor, and suddenly you can lift the whole place and produce something which is real quality. These sort of golf maintenance facilities, and they're not sheds, they're not barns. In England, they call them sheds. In America, they very often call them barns. They're not. They're maintenance facilities. They're natural resource centers. And these sort of places turn the golf facility into something that is highly efficient and cost-effective. And in order to do this, courses have to invest in training and education. It's the responsibility of the owner, the developer, the manager, to invest a modest amount of money in training and educating the people who maintain your reputation, your investment, to get the maximum out of that investment. And I commend the group here and Mike for trying for years to get operators to understand the broader implications of golf course maintenance. And we have to try to get this message over. We've got to be able to share the experiences with all of our staff, not segregate them, not push them down into a corner somewhere where the dirt and the filth is not seen. We have to communicate with them. It's a vitally important part that the owners and the managers communicate and share their experiences with the workforce and look carefully at the differences which they can make. And that's the bottom line. Lower the input costs, improve the machine life, make the investment in these very expensive machines worthwhile. By making a fairway mower last one more year, from an accountant's point of view, you can save $1,000 every single year. Now start multiplying that up across the course. By saving on the fuel, you can reduce your fuel bills by anywhere from 30 to 50%. Think what that means. You can cut down the cost of your fertilizer, fungicide, fuel. All of those costs can be lowered dramatically. And all of that comes from the simple process of maintaining a sharp reel. And I don't mean a lapped reel, I mean a sharpened reel. And it's very, very cost effective. You can keep these conditions day in and day out if you understand the process of sharpening, and you focus a little bit of your attention upon it. That is sustainable golf. Now, a lot of people say it's just too good to be true. Stop debating it. Don't think about the concepts. Just try it. Encourage your staff to investigate. You don't have to buy anything. You can borrow. You can rent. You don't have to spend capital resources, but try it. And stop talking about it, stop debating it, just try it. Lower the input costs, improve your machine life, more profit to the bottom line. Thank you. I hope you find that at least inspiring.